1327 BC, a tragic event brought Egypt to the verge of crisis. The pharaoh Tutankhamun had died. His death marked the end of Egypt's most powerful dynasty and the beginning of a period of great uncertainty. A great deal was at stake. In just two centuries, Egypt's royal family had built a massive empire stretching far beyond the Nile. From Syria in the north to the gold fields of Nubia, modern-day Sudan, in the south. A succession of powerful pharaohs had made Egypt the richest and most powerful nation in the world.
When Tutankhamun died, the big problem was that there was no heir to the throne. So obviously Egypt must have been in a bad state. There was nobody there to take over, and things were in a state of flux.
But now, with the end of the great dynasty, a new enemy had emerged to challenge Egypt's might, the Hittites. The Hittites, living in what is now Turkey, were a more technologically advanced power than Egypt. Already they were pushing against the northern border of Egypt's empire. In 1279 BC, the fate of the threatened empire became the responsibility of a young boy, the new pharaoh of Egypt. He was crowned Ramesses, meaning offspring of the sun god Ra.
Ramesses comes to the throne fairly young, probably about the age of 15. And he's got an enormous task ahead of him. He looks back over the history of his country. 100 years or so earlier, there were kings who were the epitome of wealth, power, and good taste. That's an enormous legacy to have to live up to.
Ramesses had not come from a royal background. In fact, the boy king had been born a commoner.
Ramesses' family was a military family who were fairly new on the throne. They were certainly not from the royal line. They were near the royal line. They lived and worked for the kings of Egypt, but they did not belong to the royal family.
It was military prowess that had won Ramesses' family its place on the throne. And it would be through military action that the young Ramesses would have to prove himself. To the north of Egypt, the Hittites were preparing for war. They intended to take advantage of the young and inexperienced boy king. Ramesses was about to face the biggest challenge of his life.
You have two superpowers, each one trying to grab bits from the other. And eventually, they're going to clash.
By the fifth year of Ramesses' reign, the massive Hittite army moved into Egypt's territories, advancing toward the town of Kadesh. As the crossroads for trade with the Near East, Kadesh was of extreme strategic importance.
Ramesses II realizes that the battle for the area of Kadesh, for this border, is the battle that will eventually decide which of these two empires will be the leaders of the world in the entire century, in the entire 13th century.
Here was the opportunity Ramesses had been waiting for. It was the chance to prove his power and might to the world. There was only one problem. Egypt was not ready for war. Ramesses needed an army quickly. He mobilized not just Egyptian soldiers, but other subjects of his empire, including Nubians and Libyans. The primitive bronze weapons of the Egyptian forces were soon to be pitted against the Hittites' iron armory. The odds didn't look good.
I can't imagine what it must have been like to be a soldier in Pharaoh's army. First of all, in all likelihood, you don't want to be there. You've been conscripted. Secondly, you're rather poorly fed. You're rather poorly clothed. You have a spear, or if you're lucky, a bow and arrow. And that's it. You are expected to give your all.
Soon Ramesses' army was ready. The Pharaoh's scribes also came along to record what the Pharaoh was confident would be a glorious victory.
He had all the self-confidence that can go with being young. He thought that everything was doable. He thought that problems would not exist. He probably thought that compromises wouldn't need to be made. You could just go out and do it and get it.
Finally, the 20-year-old king set off with his army, leading an advance guard out of the lush Nile Delta into the scorching heat of the Sinai Desert. The figure he cut at the helm of his army was impressive.
I can imagine that he had a great deal of power and authority. He was very strong and muscular. He was himself about 5'8", 5'9". That's about, not all that much, 4 inches or so taller than the average Egyptian man, but taller nevertheless. He had red hair, which was a very unusual feature in ancient Egypt, and it set him apart.
The Egyptian army surged across the desert through Israel and Lebanon. A few miles from Kadesh, Ramesses and his advanced guard made camp and waited for the rest of the army to catch up.
When Ramesses established this camp, he obviously was not thinking that there was going to be a battle anytime soon. This was a time to stop, have a picnic, talk about life in general, and await, maybe a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks later, some kind of a battle, which, of course, the Egyptians knew they would win.
But things weren't going to be so easy. We know from scribal accounts that the inexperienced pharaoh was about to be the victim of a dangerous trap.
There were two Bedouin in the desert who were brought in by Ramesses' soldiers and interrogated. And Ramesses or whoever said, "Where's the king of the Hittites?" And they said, "Oh, he's way off there. Don't worry about him. He's far away."
What Ramesses didn't realize was that his informants were Hittite spies sent to mislead him.
They released them and sent them off and said, "Ah, great. Well, let's set up camp and relax. We've got plenty of time before the battle begins."
The pharaoh had fallen for a simple trick.
Ramesses goofed, seriously and badly, to have taken those two Bedouins at their word, to have avoided sending out scouts to check the veracity of what they were saying, I think was a terrible, terrible military mistake.
Ramesses' soldiers captured two more spies. This time, Ramesses had them beaten and interrogated. He got a very different story. The Hittites were not hundreds of miles away. They were just across the river, ready to attack. In panic, Pharaoh sent word back for reinforcements. Suddenly, the Hittites attacked. Ramesses' scribes left an eyewitness account of the battle.
The Hittite wretch with his army forded the river south of Kadesh, smashing into His Majesty's army when it least expected an attack.
The dust, the choking dust, the blood pouring onto the desert sands, these soldiers who looked death in the face at every moment of one of these battles must have been absolute hell.
Ramesses' troops fell before the Hittites' iron weapons. The Egyptian army stood on the brink of defeat. Then, at the last minute, Ramesses' reinforcements arrived. They took the Hittites by surprise.
Ramesses has been unbelievably lucky. And he ends up at the end of the day holding the battlefield. Actually, it was something of a goalless draw and snatched from defeat at the last moment by the arrival of the Egyptian equivalent of the US cavalry.
Ramesses had failed in his mission. The Hittites would be back, and Egypt's trade routes and empire were still vulnerable.
The Battle of Kadesh did not go according to plan. At the most, it was a way for the Egyptians to prevent the Hittites from moving further south. But it was certainly not the flamboyant victory that Ramesses wanted.
Ramesses, however, was determined to have his victory. Back in Egypt, he would tell a far different story of the Battle of Kadesh.
What Ramesses does is say, right, I'm going to rewrite history. So it's going to be the big gesture. It's going to be the vainglorious boast. It's going to be the huge publicity machine. It's going to be the hieroglyphic equivalent of spin doctoring.
Ramesses now masterminded an extraordinary propaganda campaign. He sent out legions of artisans to carve epic depictions of the Battle of Kadesh on temple walls around the empire. The story he told begins truthfully, but then veers off into fantasy. The young king claimed he had won a clear victory at Kadesh, and it was not the Egyptian reinforcements, but he himself who all alone had saved the day. In Ramesses' version, he transformed himself from a gullible, inexperienced commander into a godlike warrior. Every temple wall carried the same story.
His Majesty leapt up, raging against them. He grabbed his weapons and set off at a gallop, completely alone. His Majesty was an unstoppable fighting force. Everything near him was ablaze with fire. All the foreign lands were blasted by his scorching breath.
He claims that single-handedly, after his troops had deserted him, he went into the field of battle, slashing, swaying his sword back and forth, decimating the enemies of Egypt.
He charged straight into the Hittite troops. The infantry and chariotry fell on their faces. His Majesty struck them down and killed them where they stood.
The claims of Ramesses II that his army totally abandoned him, that he was left alone on the field of battle and single-handedly defeated the Hittites, of course, is an utter load of rubbish.
Despite his boasting, Ramesses knew that his army could not defeat the Hittites. He had to cut a deal. Secretly, Ramesses began to negotiate with the Hittites. After lengthy debate, Ramesses signed a treaty with the Hittite king. Ramesses the spin doctor was now Ramesses the statesman.